Michigan, Pension Funds, Chapter 13, page 301. In performing the financial intermediation function of asset transformation, pension funds provide the public with another kind of protection: regular income payments during retirement. Employers, unions, and private individuals can set up pension plans which acquire funds through contributions from the plan's participants. As we can see in Table 1, both public and private pension plans have grown in importance with their share of total financial intermediary assets rising from 13% at the end of 1970 to 25.4% at the end of 2016. Federal tax policy has been a major factor behind the rapid growth of pension funds because employer contributions to employee pension plans are tax deductible. Furthermore, tax policy has also encouraged employee contributions to pension funds by making these contributions tax deductible as well and enabling self-employed individuals to set up their own tax-sheltered pension plans and individual retirement accounts, IRAs. Because the benefits paid out of a pension fund each year are highly predictable, pension funds invest in long-term securities, with the bulk of their asset holdings in bonds, stocks, and long-term mortgages. The key management issues associated with pension funds revolve around asset management. Pension fund managers try to hold assets with high expected returns and also try to reduce risk through diversification. They also use the techniques we discussed in Chapter 9 to manage credit and interest rate risk. The investment strategies of pension plans have changed radically over time. In the aftermath of World War II, most pension fund assets were held in government bonds, with less than 1% held in stock. However, the strong performance of stocks in the 1950s and 1960s afforded pension plans higher returns, causing them to shift their portfolios into stocks, which currently account for approximately two-thirds of their assets. As a result, pension plans now have a much stronger presence in the stock market. In the early 1950s, they held on the order of 1% of corporate stock outstanding. They currently hold on the order of 15%. Pension funds, along with mutual funds, are now the dominant players in the stock market. Although the purpose of all pension plans is the same, they can differ in a number of attributes. First is the method by which payments are made. If benefits are determined by contributions into the plan and their earnings, the pension is a defined contribution plan. If future income payments or benefits are set in advance by the pension plan, the pension is a defined benefit plan. Defined benefit plans fall into two categories. A defined benefit plan is fully funded if contributions into the plan and their earnings over the years are sufficient to pay out the defined benefits when they come due. If the contributions and earnings are not sufficient to pay out the defined benefits, the plan is underfunded. For example, if Jane Brown contributes $100 per year to her pension plan and interest rate is 10%, then after 10 years, her contributions and their earnings will be worth $1,753. If the defined benefit on her pension plan is $1,753 or less after 10 years, then the plan is fully funded because her contributions and their earnings will be sufficient to pay this amount in full. But if the defined benefit on her plan is $2,000, the plan is underfunded because her contributions and their earnings do not cover this amount. A second characteristic of pension plans is their vesting. The length of time that a person must be enrolled in the pension plan, for example, must either be a member of the union or an employee of the company before he or she is entitled to receive benefits. Typically, firms require that an employee work 5 years for the company before he or she becomes vested and is qualified to receive pension benefits. If the employee leaves the firm before the 5 years are up, because the employee either quits or is fired, all rights to the benefit are lost. Private pension plans. Private pension plans are administered by banks, life insurance companies, and pension fund managers. In employer-sponsored pension plans, contributions are usually shared between employer and employee. Many companies' pension plans are underfunded because the companies plan to meet their pension obligations by taking funds from the current earnings when the benefits come due. As long as the companies have sufficient earnings, underfunding creates no problems. But if they do not, they may not be able to meet their pension obligations. Because of problems caused by corporate underfunding, mismanagement, fraudulent practices, and other abuses of private pension funds, Teamsters pension funds are notorious in this regard. Congress enacted the Employee Retirement Income Security Act, ERISA, in 1974. This act established minimum standards for reporting and disclosure of information, set rules for vesting, put limits on the degree of underfunding allowed, placed restrictions on investment practices, and assigned responsibility for regulatory oversight to the Department of Labor. ERISA also created the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, PBGC, also called Penny Benny, which performs a role similar to that of the FDIC. It insures pension benefits up to a specific limit, currently $60,136 per year per person. If a company with an underfunded pension plan goes bankrupt or is unable to meet its pension obligations for other reasons, Penny Benny charges pension plans premiums to pay for this insurance, and it can also borrow up to $100 million from the U.S. Treasury. Unfortunately, the problem of pension plan underfunding has been growing worse in recent years. Public pension plans. The most important public pension plan is Social Security. Old Age and Survivors Insurance Fund, which covers virtually all individuals employed in the private sector. Funds are obtained from workers through FICA, Federal Insurance Contribution Act, deductions from their paychecks, and from employers through payroll taxes. Social Security benefits include retirement income, Medicare payments, and aid to the disabled. When Social Security was established in 1935, the federal government intended to operate it like a private pension fund. However, unlike a private pension plan, benefits are typically paid out from current contributions and are not closely tied to a participant's past contributions. This pay-as-you-go system led at one point to a massive underfunding estimated at more than $1 trillion of the Social Security system. The problems of the Social Security system might become worse in the future because of the growth in the number of retired people relative to the number of people working. Congress has been grappling with the problems of the Social Security system for years, but the prospect of a huge bulge in new retirees, namely the 77 million baby boomers born between 1946 and 1964, who began to retire in 2011, has resulted in calls for radical surgery on Social Security. State and local governments and the federal government, like private employers, have also set up pension plans for their employees. These plans are almost identical in operation to private pension plans and hold similar assets. Underfunding of the plans is also prevalent, and some investors in municipal bonds worry that state and local governments will be unable to meet their debt obligations in the future.